It happened the summer my cousin Kira came to town from Cumming, Georgia. I was 7 years old, Kira 6. As usual, my mom went to work on the night shift at Arkansas Children's Hospital, leaving my dad in charge of our dinner, baths, and a reasonable bedtime. She kissed us goodbye right after dinner, and we knew the next time we'd see her was right after breakfast. All responsibilities for my brother's, Kira's, and my well-being were left with my father. My parents moved to America from Ireland in the late 80s, before I was born. My mother was a nurse of 15 years, and my father an aspiring artist, who later received the prestigious Donahue Scholarship from the University of Little Rock, the University of Arkansas at Little Rock. I grew up in the popularly laid-back neighborhood of Hillcrest, where almost every street is named after a tree, mine being North Palm. There were 5 other children around my age that lived on North Palm, all of them boys, including my older brother, David. It's no secret that my father had a drinking problem for the majority of my brothers in my childhood. We theorize it started long before that, but was never noticed, or perhaps it was chosen not to be. What I remember most is Sunday afternoons while Mom was in bed, when David, Daddy, and I would go on surprises. We'd climb into our 1991 blue Ford Windstar van and end up in a field full of hay bales where Dad would photograph us. One photograph in particular ended up being a drawing of the two of us, a Christmas present to my mother. Or we'd go to Barnes & Noble so my dad could read while we went to the children's section and lazily, uninterestedly, read books far under our reading levels. Us kids were surprisingly limitless for our ages. Mom would be baking an apple pie or her famous among friends, Irish brown bread. Apple pies on good days, brown bread when she was missing home. And right before I slipped out the screen door, my bare feet prematurely calloused due to rough hop pavement and ruthless pebbles, she would call to me, "Stay with your brother." The simplicity of the rules we were to abide by gave us an unspoken and never questioned okay to play hide and seek in underground tunnels that trailed through every alley, or see whose team would dominate the other and capture the flag, where the sidewalk in front of Max's house was no man's land, or was a safe haven, also known as no man's land. I distinctively remember sitting on Adam's couch in his living room after having found a photography book illustrating a nudist camp. I didn't know what to call the heat that enveloped my face as we leafed through and saw bare nipple after bare nipple, or the tuft of a grown man's pubic hair. Us kids were invincible. From the moment we crawled out of our bunk beds until the sun went down and our mothers stood out on the porches, calling us in for dinner, or din-dins, as my father would say. We even felt invincible after our plates were successfully licked clean without any spilled milk or a dropped fork. When it was bath time and we thought if we'd hide behind a door long enough or if we ducked in the covers and didn't move, it growing more difficult to breathe in each passing moment, Dad would give up, stop running the water, and let the grime build up in the creases of our arms and the sweat between our toes crest over. Inevitably, there came a time when the popsicles we took turns licking, between runs to the sprinkler, melted, the red dye crying down our forearms, our lips cannibalistically stained as if we were just at war. In a way we were, but it was with ourselves. Each new shoe size was only a reminder that Legos and Barbies and making mud pies were noticeably less fun than the last time. Our imaginations were seeping out of every orifice. Even the excitement of reading seemed to have diminished. Mommy's voice got a little more stern, as did Daddy's once gentle, inviting hands. And so on this particular night, while Mom was at work, it was Daddy who made sure me and my cousin Kira got in bed. After the two of us were tucked in, it was as if my dad didn't exist. In our giggly world, it was just the two of us. We snuck into the bathroom at the end of the hallway, toting with us my collection of nail polish. An hour must have passed before Dad walked in on my cousin and I, bare naked, nail polish staining the floor. Even at the age of 7, I could recognize the smell of whiskey on his breath and how to measure the lowness of his eyelids in relation to how he was going to act. In the midst of my first surprised inhale of breath, my dad already had me off the floor with just one hand tightly gripping my upper arm. Immediately following that, I felt the sting of his hand ricocheting off of my bottom and tops of my legs, over and over and over. David was standing groggily in the hallway with apologizing eyes. At 10, there wasn't much defending he could do, and I understand he hated that. The next morning, I told my mother, "Daddy hit me." She pulled up my nightdress and stared at the backs of my legs for what seemed like eternity. there was that unfamiliar heat of embarrassment on my face again. Without a word, she left the room, coming back with her Magnavox film camera, and she took photos of the bruises, just in case, she told me. My father never hit me again after that summer night in 2002. My parents divorced shortly afterward, and for the most part, I've lost all contact with him, excluding the occasional email or sticky note on the front door reading, "Hey, it's Dad. I thought I'd stop by. XOXO. My last vivid memory of being a child is my father's cherry red face and his hand pelting my backside as if it was the only chance he'd ever get to do so. The strength in his slaps beat the innocence and naivety out of my being. In the few moments I was dangled by one arm in my yellow bathroom, I lamented every mud pie I'd ever made. I said goodbye to my Barbie friends, and I lost interest in getting dirty with the boys. My father turned the knob on that bathroom door. It opened, and the future rushed in.